Proxmox Backup Server version 4 has recently gotten released with a couple of neat features, and I'm most excited to see how their S3 backup implementation works, so I've done some testing, and in this video I'm going to go over my testing results and overall thoughts and experience after using Proxmox Backup Server with S3 storage. Before I dive into the fun and exciting S3 stuff though, I want to take a look at a few other things that Proxmox Backup Server version 4 brings. It's a lot of the same stuff under the hood that comes with Proxmox version 9. So it's based on the new Debian 13, it has RAID Z expansion, and it has almost all of the same new code under the hood, new kernels, a lot of the small little software that Debian uses has been updated, and more. Probably the most notable thing they listed here is RAID Z expansion. So if you, for example, have, let's say, a 5-drive RAID Z 2, or essentially RAID 6-like configuration of double parity, and want to just add a 6th or 7th or 8th drive to that configuration, you can just add an additional drive, and even though it's technically slightly worse at using the additional space than a traditional RAID expansion would, it's pretty much just fine, and I think I've done a video on it in the past. So it's really nice to have feature if you want easy expansion by adding a single disk to RAID Z. The other thing they add that's a little bit exciting is you now have automatic support for plugging in another external hard drive and have it automatically start to sync. This makes it a lot easier to do rotated hard drive backups, where you just plug in a hard drive, it does an updated sync and just keeps putting new data on it, and then you can just put it off-site for a little bit and swap in that off-site backup drive on-site now so it has a updated copy. I like using rotated hard drives for smaller environments because it's an easy way for me to get off-site backups without having to have an off-site location that has internet and power, although I do have to manually move drives to and from off-site. Now let's get into the meat of the video and talk a little bit about S3 compatible storage. I think this is a really neat feature because S3 storage is sold from a large amount of providers, so Amazon, who originally made the API, amongst almost all the other large cloud providers like Google's, Microsoft, and many of the other more storage-focused providers like Wasabi, Backblaze, amongst many others out there. And the great thing with this cloud storage is I can buy a relatively small amount of it for a fairly low cost, have it replicated between different sites fairly easily, and more. And especially if your company you're working with already has S3 storage, it might be a great way to get an off-site backup that is going to be much cheaper than setting up a whole co-located server if you only need a small amount of backup. I do want to make one quick note about this implementation, is that it's currently listed as a beta feature within it, so I would just be careful and run some additional tests and likely wait for it to come out of beta before pushing it onto a prod system. I also want to take a quick note to talk about pricing with these S3 storage things. And this is one thing that made me a little bit kind of curious how they'd implement it. S3 storage typically charges you by terabyte you use per month or some other period of time in storage. But they also often bill you based on the amount of API calls. So for example, these API calls can be things like sending data to them, pulling data back, and doing other things like reading what data you have stored, changing the amount of buckets or how the data is stored, and more. Depending on the provider, these can all have very different fees depending on how you're implementing it. So having something like PBS minimize the amount of API calls it's doing is probably a big feature for using S3 storage, which I looked into more later on in this video, to try to keep your costs low. Generally, I think PBS does a pretty good job at minimizing the amount of storage you use, but S3, you also have to think about API calls, because on a traditional mechanical drive or SSD, that's essentially free. You don't have to pay for access on those drives. Let's take a little bit of a look at the implementation on this system. So within PBS version 4, there's a new thing here under configuration, which is S3 endpoints. So now on S3 endpoints, you can set an ID, which is user set, set the endpoint, which is essentially going to be the bucket name, and then the web address that your provider gives you, as well as the location of their server. And then you have an access key and a secret key, which is going to be essentially its password. And there's one more thing under advanced, which is provider quirks, a skip if none match header. I was doing my testing using Backblaze, and it looks like this has to be enabled. If you run into something weird going on, try enabling that. It might need to be enabled. Then, once you add that, you can go under Add Data Store. And under Data Store Type, you can now change this to S3 Tech Preview, add a local cache, and then set your endpoint ID, and it'll look at the list of buckets you have and which buckets you can use. I found an interesting bug that it seems to, or a feature that isn't well documented, and it seems to require everything to be lowercase, because when I used uppercase for camel case in my bucket name, it would run into issues and say regex failed. It doesn't seem to be documented from everything I can see, but it looks like you should have all lowercase and probably use dashes or underscores if you wanted to separate your words. The other interesting thing to note is they want you to use a local cache. In the documentation for PBS, one thing it notes is that it doesn't have to be that big. Their recommended number is somewhere between 64 and 128 gigs, and they recommend either using a smaller partition or using a ZFS quota to limit the amount of space so the cache doesn't just get huge. I tried using a ZFS quota, and it would run into a weird issue where it would essentially fill up the ZFS quota and fail and say quota limit reached. Not sure, I noticed it can be multiple ways to set quotas and I was doing that wrong, but when I set up an 80 gigabyte partition, it worked just fine and would never fill the hard drive on that specific cache drive. So on the system, I've set up a couple of them here. My little test 2 right here is using Backblaze, as well as my Backblaze one here. And then once that is set up, it's going to be sent to that S3 storage to be stored on. Now, one thing I was curious about is how does PBS actually store its data on S3 and how does it work with the cache? So on my system, I can just see my S3 buckets and I can access them. And sometimes it actually takes some time to build the file tree because there's a lot of files. And the TLDR of this is it stores files the exactly the same way on S3 as it does with local PBS. And essentially that means it has a lot of folders depending on the digits that the GUID starts. And then depending on the checksum, it has a file for each possible checksum with the data stored inside of it. It's exactly the same way PBS stores its chunk data on a local disk. It just stores it in S3 and updates it as needed. Now, I was immediately a little bit worried of would this cause performance issues or be super slow to run backup, because that's a lot of small files that need to be sent and maybe that causes issues. So I did quite a few different backup jobs. And essentially, I get the same speeds uploading to the backup servers as I would expect if I was just using it for anything else. Many of the S3 providers, like Backblaze here, have a speeds test on their site. And this shows you how fast you can access their Backblaze storage, and while not a perfect estimate of speed, generally shows about what I can expect. And I notice I get pretty bad upload speed here, and I am on a home gig symmetrical connection, but a lot of these home grade connections aren't great, and I get much faster speeds using some of my systems that have business grade connections and essentially get the full advertised download speed on those connections. So I would say speed is about what I'd expect being able to access it, and it looks like how it handles chunks works fine, and it's reasonably fast at synchronizing it. The next thing I was thinking about is how fast can it remove old backup? Because how Proxmox Backup Server works, where it can't just delete a single file to get rid of that old backup, it has to look at all the old versions, prune which ones you don't want, and then look through all the files and garbage collect them. Running a garbage collection job is a little bit slower than a local SSD definitely could do, but not unusably slow when I ran it multiple times. I would say it runs fully within the usably fast test, and I have a few screenshots of when I ran it. It was about a terabyte total of backups, and I made backups on, I think, about 8 systems every 30 minutes. So I was pruning hundreds of backup snapshots each time. If you have a huge workload, performance could definitely get slow, but I would say it was never any unacceptably slow for all the backup tests I ran. Because there's often a lot of different S3 providers you can pick from, I would typically look at other providers if you're having slower speed with some providers than others, because your network connection and ISP might have a better connection to one person's data center than another one's. So that might be worth looking into if you have slower backup. The other thing I was curious about is how does it handle the checking of the backups? So you can run verify jobs on here, tell it to run, and it'll essentially read all of the chunks, compare it to the known checksum for those chunks, and let you know if there's any corrupted files. But compared to running it on local storage, where essentially I/O is nearly free if that disk I/O isn't being used for anything else, I have to take account of how much do I want to pay for those API calls. So on my systems here, I could take a look at my API calls. So this is Backblaze, and every provider is going to be a little bit different, but generally they're kind of close in how they handle it. Class A is uploading files, and that is free because, well, you have to pay to store those files you uploaded, at least on Backblaze. Class B is download, where they let you download 2,500 API calls a day, but past that is paid. So that pretty quickly gets into the paid if you want to do any sort of download. And then these sorts of things, these class C's all charged, I believe, past 2500 again, and they feature things like list objects, which is used quite a bit when checking which files need to be used on here. The overall experience I had when using S3 was reasonably good. It runs fairly quickly. It works like any other local storage, and it seems like the cache is helping speeding stuff up. But unfortunately, the documentation on what exactly the cache is doing isn't great. It says it requires a local cache to improve the performance, but it doesn't give anything on how a bigger cache would help or anything else. And I didn't see any super fast restores, for example, or anything else from that larger cache being added. But with this sort of storage, what really matters is being able to recover your data from a new system in case all your on-site system failed, which is probably when you'd want to be able to use off-site or cloud backup. So in this case, I took another PBS server in a different location, different IP, mounted that same S3 endpoint here, added it as a data store, and then whenever I go to create a new data store and set it to an S3 data store under advanced, I have this new option of reuse existing data store. Another thing that tripped me up a little bit is I actually have to go under and use the exact same name as I was using previously. Because if I don't do that, it'll just make another folder and build a new chunk tree on it. So I have to, for example, here use this bs9-pbs-2 instead of using whatever specific name I'd want for it locally. So I have to use the same name. But once I do that and have this reuse check, I can go more, I can go refresh contents. It takes a minute or two in my experience for that couple of hundred of snapshots. And then I have all of the exact same ones available. I could restore these directly or I could copy these to a local data store. So in this example here, I named it to something called BS9 VMs and I have all these files on my offsite's local storage that I can do other things with. They all check some correctly, I can verify them and it generally just works. The offsite restore function works pretty well, reasonably good performance, and when storing backups, I got kind of, I think, in the 600 some megabit range, which is what I expect for that internet connection in the offsite storage. Overall, pretty nice experience, and I can see this making a good amount of sense for PBS users that want to be able to use cloud storage, potentially already have some S3 accounts or work with the cloud providers. And in my view, I think it makes the most sense for a relatively low amount of storage user. I can run my own calculations, but due to the extra API cost, if you're running frequent verified jobs and typically the higher cost of storage compared to building your own box, if you can have someone build a custom box and co-locate it, it's likely going to be cheaper if you're going to fully utilize that hardware. But as I said before, S3 makes a lot of sense because you can just get 100 gigs of it for just a handful of dollars a month in at least my US market and get offsite backups really easily. So that's the great thing that I like to see. I think the implementation of PBS into S3 isn't the most optimal as it is built upon the chunk system, which is very IO and thus API and thus cost heavy compared to other ways of using local storage. But overall, the implementation wasn't that bad from my experience. The billing costs aren't that much higher due to those API calls if you keep things like verified jobs to a reasonable amount. And PBS is pretty good when it comes to deduplication, so I'm likely going to keep my storage costs fairly low. And it's also nice to see that PBS now has options, so I can back up to my own server in an offsite location. I can use rotated hard drives and move them physically offsite if I don't want to have an internet-connected offsite backup solution. And I can also use S3 storage to use basically any cloud or large block provided storage that I have. One other potential use of this is to use it with on-site S3 storage, like potentially a large Ceph cluster, but I'd be tempted to run your own performance test between that and just running something like ZFS locally, because I think the ZFS would perform quite a bit better and just require less hardware to get that given amount of performance. Let me know what you think about S3 being added to PBS in the comments below. I'm curious to hear your thoughts and if you plan on using a feature like this. And if you've used it, what your experiences are using it. Thanks for watching this video, and let me know if you have any other ideas for videos in the comments below.